Hello and welcome to the KPI Institute's webinar, The Relationship Between Strategic Objectives, KPIs and Initiatives. My name is Andrei Kostya and I will be your host for today, along with our presenter, Adrian Brudan. This webinar is part of a series of free educational materials that aim to enhance the knowledge and know-how of those interested, while also creating a bridge between us as a company and you, our public. The KPI Institute is a research organization specialized in business performance. It operates research programs in 12 practice domains, each linked to a certification course, ranging from strategy and KPIs to employee performance, and from customer service to innovation performance. Today, 15 years after the KPI Institute was created, we can proudly say that our products and services have reached professionals on 5 continents, and that our public comprises a worldwide community of around 100,000 members online, and more than 30,000 registered companies on smartkpis.com. This is the second webinar of a 5 webinar series through which we aim to tackle some of the challenges encountered in the field of business performance and set the blueprint of what it means to design a solid performance measurement and management architecture. This presentation will be delivered by Adrian Brudan, General Manager of the KPI Institute's European, Middle Eastern and African Branch and Overseeing Manager of the Global Performance Audit Unit, the GPA Unit, the Strategy and Performance Audit Division of the KPI Institute. Adrian is an expert researcher, consultant and practitioner with over 10 years of experience in the deployment and implementation of performance management frameworks. This presentation lasts approximately 30 to 40 minutes. Please feel free to ask any questions you might have during the webinar, as they will be answered at the end of the presentation in our Q&A session. Enjoy the KPI Institute's webinar, The Relationship Between Strategic Objectives, KPIs and Initiatives. Now, I would like to invite Adrian to begin his presentation.
So, welcome to the second webinar in the series I've put together for this month of May. Given the situation with the global crisis, lockdown, and so on, I thought that it would be nice to share some insights, some recommendations from my experience with the professionals interested in the field of strategy and performance management. So here we are with the second webinar in the series, and we'll discuss today about the relationship between objectives, KPIs, initiatives. The idea is to move on with discussion on 30-40 minutes, and then we'll have a session of Q&A. We'll see how long it will take, generally 15 minutes, but if there are more questions, I will be gladly answering them. How I'm planning to start all this? Well, we'll start with the first webinar in review, because this will pretty much give us the general context, and then we'll drill down into objectives, KPIs and initiatives. And because the time it's short, we'll just kick off with the review of the first webinar. So in the first webinar, we've discussed about performance management tools. In general, we've tried to make the difference between what is an objective and what is an initiative, what is a metric versus a KPI, what is the difference between values and value drivers, between vision and mission, and so on. The purpose of doing this is to create a common language, standardization across organization before you start any performance management system implementation, but also during such projects. It is welcomed instead of not doing anything. This is one of the major challenges organizations are facing from my point of view, or one of those challenges. The fact that professionals do not speak the same language, they do not have the same understanding, and because of this, all the issues with accountability, buy-in, support, and so on. So one of the first recommendations from me all the time when you have such projects in place of deploying and nurturing a culture based on performance is to create a common language, to make a clear understanding of the tools, about the instruments and the systems that you are using in your own organization. So for the beginning, I will play for you a video which will make a review pretty much of what we've discussed last Sunday, and then we'll proceed with what I'm planning to share with you for the day. Good. Okay, let me just make sure that that's fine. And here you go. Mm-hmm.
Scorecards, dashboards, objectives, KPIs are all examples of conceptual tools that can be used to monitor and improve performance. KPI selection, data gathering, and performance reporting are processes that make use of such tools. Software such as Microsoft Excel and hardware such as whiteboards are tangible tools that streamline the above-mentioned processes and conceptual tools. A key aspect is, how should they be connected to an integrated manner so that we make the most out of them? The solution is the configuration of an integrated system that links all such tools, processes, underlying infrastructure, and responsible persons for using them. This is the essence of performance architecture, designing functional performance systems. To be successful in building performance systems, you need both quality components and a smart architecture of connections and interdependencies. Some of the key building blocks of performance systems are brought together from different disciplines: strategy, performance management, project management, and process management. They are: destination, mission statement, why you exist, vision statement, where you want to be, value statements, beliefs that influence organizational behavior, core strategy, value drivers, characteristic of operational activities that reflect how value is generated for stakeholders, objective, specific reflection of what we need to achieve as part of our journey towards vision attainment, goal, clustering tool for objectives linked around the same theme. Measurement, metric, quantifiable expression of something we can measure. KPI, metric reflecting performance. Target, specific level we want to achieve in relation to a KPI. Action, portfolio, collection of all projects. Program, clustering tool for projects linked around the same theme. Initiative or project, activity with start dates and specific outputs to be generated. Milestone, main task stages within a project. Processes, succession of steps in delivering outputs of day-to-day operations. Understanding such tools is an important prerequisite for designing their integration within performance systems.
Okay, and that's what I want to share with you in regards with what we've discussed last Sunday. Now, let's proceed a little bit and clarify a few things. Basically, the main components of a performance management system when we want to deploy and execute strategy are the objectives, KPIs, and initiatives. I think that everyone is able to see the screen now again. Now, when it comes to this component strategy, it's about planning, of course, and generally it's represented through a strategic plan. In performance management, you can have a one pager that at the KPI Institute, we call it a desired state of evolution. Why it's important to have a summary of the strategic plan? Because strategies are meant to be communicated. So hence the importance of making sure that you are enabling this sort of actions by having a one, two pager summary of the strategy. Now, strategy is high level, generally it's defined on a 3 to 5 year basis, but how can you make sure that you are executing the strategy? Well, you need to translate it, and how you'll translate it is through the objectives, of course. Objectives which are specific reflection of your strategy, mainly they are developed on a 1 year basis, but of course, if the strategy doesn't change, you are not going to change these objectives either. And they reflect the doing part. They reflect how you do in terms of what you've planned. That's why objectives generally they start with an action verb: improve, maintain, explain, enhance, ensure, and so on. Yes, because the action verb reflects the dynamics all the time of what you do in terms of what you plan. In a performance management architecture, generally they are represented through a strategy map, or a map on which you can visualize the strategy, as the word is saying. It's a popular tool used by the balanced scorecard concept generally, which is one of the most popular systems used in strategy and performance. But even if you do not call it balanced scorecard any longer, generally such tools are in place under one name or the other. As the principle, it's a simple one. It's a way of visualizing as a helicopter view your strategy represented through these objectives. Now, you know how to do what you have planned, but you need to know if what you do is making sense. So you need to check. How you'll check through the use of KPIs, of course. And at the root, a KPI, it's a measurable expression to which you attach a target, and hence here you get a measurement reflecting performance. Of course, for KPIs, you need to know more than just that. But the KPIs are generally the tools reflecting on how you are achieving what you are or giving value and flavor in relation to what you are doing to your objectives. They are represented through scorecards and dashboards. In the scorecards, you have the KPIs reflecting the measuring the objectives. In the dashboard, you have all sorts of other metrics and subordinate measures, maybe of the KPIs. Generally, dashboards, as I was mentioning last time, it's a supporting tool for the scorecards, more operational, while the scorecard is more strategic, but you can have them both at any given level in your organization, particularly the organization level, departmental level, maybe even team level in some respects. Having the KPIs will not solve your problems, isn't it? Because you still need to make sure that you are going to achieve those KPIs targets, which reflect the desired level of results, which means that you'll meet your objectives and your strategy. So in order to do this, you'll need to act. This will be done through the use of projects or initiatives, and generally these projects or initiatives are generally visualized as part of a portfolio of initiatives, where under each objective, you'll have mapped all the projects that entitles you to achieve this objective is through by meeting the KPI targets pretty much. All of these are mainly one-page tools, and put together they provide us with a blueprint of a performance management architecture, if you want, based on a balanced scorecard concept. If it's an old concept, your performance management architecture. So the strategic plan, desired state, strategy map, scorecard and dashboard and portfolio of initiatives. And of course, there are supporting tools for all these main visualization instruments, such as documentation forms, descriptions forms, and so on. And such architectures definitely can be cascaded down from one level to another, from corporate level to operational level, and then why not to the individual level. Actually, that will be ideal, to be able to have this cascading down across all organizational levels. The cascading is done at the level of strategy, at the level of objectives. This is what you'll cascade, and of course with objectives will come the KPIs and the projects. Projects, the strategic projects, but as you move on towards lower levels, you will end up with specific objectives and KPIs, operational projects, and same here at individual level with specific KPIs related to the job description, as well as different tasks as part of these projects for individuals. Yeah. So pretty much that's the integration of all these tools as part of the performance management system. The KPIs, as you can see, stay at the middle of the entire story. It makes the connection between the objectives and the initiatives and allows you to understand and to improve better decision making. Yeah? So basically, instead of making assumptions, if I'm doing that, I'm achieving that. The other thing, basically the KPIs through numbers, through measurement, allows you to understand how far you are towards a certain level of expectations. And hence, you'll be able to assess the impact of your initiatives and to be in a better position to understand if what you are doing is making sense or if you need to adjust your actions, your priorities, your initiatives in terms of achieving better results. So overall, it provides clarity, focus, and allows improvement to happen. Now, before moving on and discussing about the objectives, I want just to go quickly through these statements here and to see which one of these are examples of KPIs. I will provide you insights and some clarification as well. Generally, employee satisfaction is a popular example of a KPI, isn't it? So that's something that you'll find in many frameworks. Also, when we talk about surveys, customer satisfaction at customer level will be even a more popular one. turnover, if we look here at the symbol, and we'll discuss about the symbols towards the end, so it reflects the revenue. Basically, for profit organizations is another important KPI. But if we look at finalized projects by 31st of December, that's definitely not a reflection of a measurable expression. It's more of a milestone. So definitely is not something you'll measure. Number of clients from referrals, on the other hand, it's a popular KPI used by services companies. And the KPI Institute has these KPIs in our scorecard, and it's one of the things that we are aiming for. Yes, if you have clients from referrals, this means that clients are pretty much satisfied with what you are doing. But if we look at the number of employees, well, that's pretty much not necessarily a KPI. That's a metric. Yes, indeed. Very nice insights from you guys. Popularly, it's used as a metric. Everyone needs to measure how many employees they have because they need to know who they have to pay and who they have to manage. However, these metrics, if they are selected and the target will be attached to them, they can become a KPI. For the ones that attended my previous program, but also for the others, all KPIs are metrics, are measurable expression. Not all metrics will be selected and become KPIs, because not everything that you are that moves is relevant for managing your business. Of course, looking into current situation, number of employees started to become a more relevant measurement, translated into a KPI if you want, for organizations, because many of them, unfortunately, they try to downsize. So from 1,000 employees, maybe they want to reach 500 employees. So they need to attach a target. They need to have actions. And for a certain period of time, until the situation will be stabilized and the target will be met, that will become a KPI. But these are the, let's say, special situations. Mainly, such a measurement will be used only as a metric. Percentage of projects delivered on time and on budget, on the other hand, is an important KPI. Most of the organizations should measure actually this KPI. It's an index, if we look at it, formed from two components. Generally, a KPI is measuring one component. Indexes bring together different flavors in one score. In this case, the popular way of representing it is by looking into on time on budget, but you can look also on specification. So you can have the three components, or you can have only one of these. Quality. Well, quality, it's not measuring anything as it is described, but a KPI can reflect quality. Quality per se, it's a value driver. It's a characteristic that allows you to understand how you can create value for your organization. But if we look at the defect rate, it's one KPI that we can say that it reflects the quality of the production system. In this case, if we would have had error rate of the services provided. Generally, defects are associated with production, errors with services. Budget, if we go further, well, that's a pure example of a metric. Again, thank you, Karim, for your insights. Why? Because if you have a $10 million budget, this doesn't say anything about your performance. Yes, generally budgets are built and are given, and the idea is to spend them wisely and in full. Why? Because you want to maximize and improve performance, your efforts and improve performance. On the other hand, if we want to translate it into a KPI or transform it into a KPI, that will be percentage budget variance or deviation from the budget. That will be the KPI in relation with the budget. Last but not least is where I wanted to reach, actually, is the last one, increase market share to 28%. Yes, again, some of you were mentioning, it might look like, okay, a KPI, it has a market share, it has a target, but overall, it starts with an action verb, and if it starts with an action verb, definitely, it's reflecting an objective. Increase market share to 28% is what, if you want, a part of what we call a SMART objective. So SMART, coming from specific, measurable, achievable, realistic, time-bound, isn't it? Yes. So actually, on the next slide, we have such an example, and that's option one, increase market share to 20% by the end of the financial year under the marketing director coordination. Many organizations try to write these SMART objectives. They feel that if they do not include all these components, that's not an objective. Well, that's one way of writing the objectives, and you can proceed with this. But at the KPI Institute, and per my recommendations, if you want my 2 cents, I do not recommend, I wouldn't emphasize on this option. It's a valid one, but it has a lot of hiccups if you want. So I prefer to keep the structure in a more simple, standardized way. And this means that such a smart objective should be decomposed in the following components. Keep the objectives in terms of what you do specific, clear, simple. In this case, increase market share. Yes. Then come up with a KPI measuring the objective. In this case, we have percentage market share, the name of the KPI, of course. And then as components of this KPI, you can have target 20%, you can have time, you can have the owner and many other components, because these are not the only things that we should know about a KPI, as many of you probably know. And we'll discuss about this in one of our next webinars when we'll discuss about KPI documentation. But it's about definition, purpose, limitations, trends, frequency, and other things that have to be included in a KPI documentation form in order to better understand how to manage such a KPI in relation with objectives and the strategy overall. Now, what are the advantages of having such a structure in place? Well, it provides you a lot of flexibility, first of all. Why? Because you do not need to change the name of the objective every time when you change a component of an objective, such as the smart ones. If you change the target and you need to review the target, automatically you need to review the name of this objective in all the places where it is written, especially if it's also cascaded to different levels. So if you keep the architecture simple, you do not need to make any change here. And an objective such as this one can stay in an organizational architecture maybe forever, either under this form, increase market share, either in a mild form. If you've already achieved a peak, you can say we do not increase market share any longer, we are going to maintain market share, for example. Yes, but generally you do not need to make any changes if you keep it simple. And then you might ask, okay, good, Adrian, but how is smart then? Well, it's very simple. The KPI is a smart expression, guys. So a KPI is a smart expression in itself. Otherwise, it wouldn't be a KPI. A KPI needs to be specific, measurable, achievable, realistic, time-bound at least, and many other things in order to be a KPI. Otherwise, it's anything else but not a KPI. So KPI is a smart expression. If I'm attaching a KPI to such a simple objective, that objective will become smart from the perspective of the KPI I am measuring it with. But the benefit here is the fact that actually when I'm keeping such a simple structure with the name of objectives and the KPIs without any sort of other components, I will have a lot of flexibility of measuring this objective also from different other perspectives. So when we talk about market share, we do not need to talk and measure it only from the perspective of the percentage market share. We can discuss about this from the perspective of number of new customers, or from the perspective of sales volume, for example, or from the perspective of new services developed. Yeah. So this means that an objective can be reflected and can be measured from different perspectives with different KPIs. And then for each of these KPI, percentage market share, number of new customers, number of new services developed, and so on, we can have different components of what means smart. Target, time frame, owner, data custodian, and so on. And if we need to make a change because we've achieved the target, or because we need to adjust maybe the responsible and so on, we do not need to change the name of the KPI or the name of the objective. The only thing that we need to do is basically to go into the field where we have the target, adjust it, and update the version of the document containing such information. And the other beautiful thing with keeping such a structure is the fact that you can change the KPIs from one period to another, from one year to another, depending on how you are improving your performance. While some KPIs will stay forever, some of the other KPIs reflecting areas of improvement can be changed. So this year I can keep percentage market share and number of new customers. Next year I can remain with market share, but instead of new customers, I can measure sales volume or something else without changing the objective and without changing anything else. If I need to change a target again, I do not need to change the name of the KPI in all the documents where this is plugged in. I just need to change that particular component. And it's a beautiful way of also, or it's a beautiful enable when it comes to cascading, because some objectives will be cascaded across different levels and across different functions within the same organization. So you will keep the same architecture with the objective and maybe even the KPI, and you'll change only the target, or you'll keep the objective and you'll change the KPI if you'll measure that objective from a different perspective. So definitely these are as many reasons for why I would recommend to keep option two as your first place to go when it comes to work with objectives in relation with the KPIs and in relation with the initiatives pretty much. Now, what will happen if you move on with such long sentences? Well, you can lose focus, for example, and this happened with these guys from Panama Canal Authority. So we have here a case study, and actually we are going to work with a little bit towards the end of our session. And these guys try to come up with a set of strategic objectives. In 2009, in their annual report, they called them goals. Well, that's inconsistency in the use of terminology. First of all, goals are not objectives. Goals are strategic directions, strategic themes, strategic pillars, high-level translations of the strategy, in other words. So they wanted actually to have here objectives, smart objectives, but they called them goals. On the other hand, let's see what happened with these smart objectives. Are they really objectives or something else? If we look at the first one, to obtain profit before interest, taxes, depreciation, and amortization, which is EBITDA, more than $1.1 billion up to September 30, 2009, pretty much they check all the components of SMART. Isn't it? It's specific, measurable, achievable, realistic, time-bound. But let's look into statement 2, 3, and 4 and see if they are the objectives or something else. Establish new pricing structure. New pricing structure establishment. Well, that's not an objective. That's a means to an end. Why they need to establish a new pricing structure? Because they want to maximize profitability here. So that's an initiative. Preliminary report of the technical cooperation project provision. That's not even a project. It's a task, part of a project. And then you have implement planned activities for third set of lock project up to September 30. So these guys wanted to develop a new set of locks. Basically, Panama Canal is making the connection between Pacific and Atlantic Ocean. So ships are moving from one side to another through these locks. So they want to have another set of locks so they could have more ships moving from one side to another. Why? Because they want to maximize their profitability. So that's pretty much a milestone part of this project. So overall, instead of ending up with strategic objectives, they ended up with milestones, tasks, or initiatives, but definitely not with strategic objectives. This is something very common that is happening in organizations from multiple reasons. One of them is because they are trying to come up with these very long sentences. And another issue with this is that you are not going to remember them. And when you want to communicate strategy, it's going to be very complicated. It's very hard to remember a lot of words in these statements, but it's much easier to say our objective is to maximize profit, to increase market share, to expand service delivery, and then this will come with the KPIs, with the targets, and so on. The other issue is that you are losing the focus, isn't it? As these guys, as it happened with these guys. But this is a common challenge with many organizations. Now, if we go in 2016, so 7 years later, the same annual report here, Dave, we can see some improvements. They do not call these statements their strategic architecture goals any longer, and they came up with the proper terminology of an objective. They are not trying to come with smart expressions, but still there are a lot of issues with these statements because they are too long, they have too many details, and some of them include, instead of the purely the objective, also other components. And this is what I want to actually finalize the discussion with. And probably it will take around 10 minutes to do that, but I think it's going to be very insightful for you, or hopefully it will be. I will try to, let me just first make sure that I'm not using this. Okay. And I will share a screen with you again. Hopefully I will share this screen. Okay, so that's the screen I want to use. Notes. Okay. So now you should see the screen. What I've did here on this screen, pretty much I've tried to, I copy pasted the objectives from the PowerPoint. These are the ones from 2016. And what I want to do with you now is to try to see how we can review them and how we can make them pretty much more relevant. Good. Hopefully you are able to see the Excel file. Just if someone can thumb up, but we should be fine with this. Yes, we have two notes, so we are good. Okay, and let's take them one by one. So first objective, develop the business by expanding the portfolio of services and products. Good. How we can make it a little bit more relevant in terms of the objective? Well, pretty much here they want to expand the market share, sort of. That's much more simple, clear, easy to use. And then we can attach a KPI. For example, if they want to expand the portfolio of services, new services developed, we can measure with it. And then in terms of initiatives, because in order to be able to achieve the target once is set for this KPI, we need to act. For example, we can have an initiative such as service expansion, services expansion program, or something around developing these new services, innovation program, or something around it. Yeah, so you can come up here with all sorts of initiatives. Now, when you make the connection between initiatives, KPIs, and objectives, as you see, we came with the initiatives at the end. Maybe some projects are already in place. Yeah, but once you have the KPIs, the first thing to do is to connect the existing projects or initiatives with what you you selected as measurements for your objective. And if it is required, you can add other projects, or you might end up acknowledging the fact that you are not doing anything. So you need to come and propose projects from start. Of course, what we are doing here are some examples. We do not know the exact context, so this is just an educated guess of what they are doing. And for me, it's important to send this message related to how you can make the connection between objectives, KPIs, and initiatives, and how to write and work with these tools in a proper way. Good. Let's move on to the next one. We'll take the line and then we'll move on downwards. Implement best practices in terms of business management and corporate governance. Again, very long, not too easy to look at it. So let's make it shorter. Enhance corporate governance practices. Pretty much this can cover a lot. And as KPIs, we can come up with processes and procedures mapped related to this governance, and maybe how many of these processes and procedures were also improved once they are mapped. Again, these are some examples of KPIs. When you have the context, it will be much easier to work with these tools. More than that, it's very important. When the KPI Institute is invited to develop such or to support organizations with performance management systems implementations, we are not going to go there and tell them what to measure and what are their objectives and what initiatives they should look into. Because they are the ones, or you are the ones that have all these details. So we are facilitators of the process. Of course, you can provide recommendations, but at the end of the day, the stakeholders in the organizations have to come up with all these insights. As initiatives, we can have a corporate governance policies, maybe development or review. You can have an organizational chart, maybe a review in order to better understand the governance and so on. Could be many other things. Okay, if there are some typos, I will deal with them later on. I can, with one of my eyes, I can see what you are writing on the chat, and this webinar is recorded, and hopefully if the recording will be converted, I will be sharing this with you, as well as the Excel file that I'm working in. So whenever I'm working with a client and I'm using these files, I prefer to share with them what we are working. So what I'm doing here is for you, mainly not necessary for me. Moving on, transform the organization and develop its capabilities to benefit of new business opportunities. Again, very long. So what's the key from here? Develop organization key capabilities. Or as simple as that, or develop key capabilities. Yeah. Percentage of you can measure it with key capabilities developed at desired level or just developed. Yeah. And then in the definition, you'll clarify at what level, at what means desired level. And then they were talking here about transformed organization, and you can have a transformation program, which is in place in many organizations. It's a program with start date, but not necessarily with end date. And then under this here, you can have all sorts of other initiatives related to how you are going to develop all these organizational key capabilities. So as you can see already, it's a much easier way to work out with all these concepts if you keep things clear, concise, and so on. Moving on, increase net profit. We do not have too many left, only three or four. Increase net profit and productivity in a sustainable manner. Now, what's the issue here? Well, the issue here is the fact that in one statement, you have actually two objectives. One related to profit and one related to productivity. In order to increase profitability, you need to, in order to increase profit or maximize profit, you need to increase productivity. That's like common sense to do it. So yes, on one hand, you can have an objective around maximize profitability, and you can measure it with a lot of KPIs in this area, like net profit margin, the level of expenditures, maybe because the profit is equation between revenue and expenses. And on the other hand, they are talking about sustainable manner. So the idea is not to waste your money here and there, but to try to do it in a proper way. And as initiatives, what? We've discussed about it. First set of logs development. They want to have this set of logs. And then you can have one related to expenditures, cost optimization program. Basically, for each KPI, you should have a project, or if you have a project that deals with both KPIs, perfect. That's something that you can do. But on the other hand, through this, we've treated only part of the objective. It's very clear it relates to profit. What about the other one? The other one relates to productivity. Enhance productivity. Actually, this is an objective mainly related to the internal processes, not to the financial part. Yes, by enhancing productivity, you maximize profitability. It can be one of those cause and effect relations that you can measure. I don't know, you can measure time to process a ship because you need to move these ships and there's a lot of assistance that have to be done for them, and ships processed on these logs on time, for example. And then as initiatives, you can have technology upgrade. You might need to have access to all sorts of technologies, technical training, provision. Just give you some examples. So that's the way to move in a proper way with this. Moving to the next one, ensure the availability and quality of water resources for consumptions and for the Panama Canal operations. Again, two distinct aspects. On one hand, they are talking about consumption water. On the other hand, they are talking about water for running the operations. So ensure water availability. It's one thing, and then we can have percentage water availability, and you can measure it according water available over water required. And then you have, I don't know, equipment modernization, pumping equipment modernization, or something related to this, or in a ways to be able to capture this water. And then you have secure consumption consumption, water, quality, because they are talking about consumption water, which is a different story. Yeah. And for this, you can have water quality. And there are specific ways in, you can have an index, but you can measure different components of the water to make sure that it's potable, it's usable. And these initiatives, you can have water purification station, for example. You need to install a purification station or something like this. So two different things. The idea is not to put three objectives in one statement, because it's going to mess up your entire execution of your strategy. And also, it will be very complicated when you want to move on with the cascading at lower levels and so on. Finally, increase trust and credibility in, I think, Panama Canal Authority management. Well, what can we look here into? Increase trust and credibility. Yes, these guys, they are not very trustful, so probably you need to increase their trust. I don't know, transparency can be one of the things. Reports released on time, performance reports released on time. Let me put it like this, because that's one challenge a lot of organizations are facing. You are measuring performance and then you are not sharing it with the stakeholders. And from here, how can you expect to have buy-in? You cannot have buy-in if you're not doing this. And you can have a strategy communication program into place, which is another challenge in many organizations, because you do not have such a program with a start date and without an end date. Such programs should run maybe forever, as long as you are managing your strategy. And as part of them, you should have all sorts of initiatives such as communication, transparency, and other things that you'll have to do in order to keep your colleagues updated with what's happening in the organization, so they can provide you with ideas of improvement. It's as simple as that. Last one, strengthen the relation with clients and foster business intelligence. Again, two things in one pot. On one hand, we talk about customers. On the other hand, we talk about business intelligence, which is pretty much an internal process aspect. So we can have the strengthen customer relationships as one objective, and we can measure with, I don't know, percentage customer satisfaction. We can measure it with things such as meetings with key customers, because they talk about the relationship with the client. So maybe they try to look into this. On the other hand, and as initiatives, you have what? Focus groups with key clients, for example, customer satisfaction survey deployment, and other things that you can do as part of such an objective. But you have the other one, foster business intelligence. It's about business intelligence. And here you can measure with percentage of automated processes. You can measure it with things such as organization functions or capabilities supported by BI, by business intelligence systems. And as initiatives, you'll come with, I don't know, system automation. Can be one of the initiatives or projects or programs that you'll put together in order to make all these things happen. So pretty much that's the way on to move on with, let's say, a best practice in terms of writing objectives. And as you can see, when you write objectives, intuitively in your mind, you'll think of some of the KPIs and projects and initiatives. But when it comes to the KPI selection, well, generally this is not done from thin air as I did it now. You can implement different techniques. You can have a very detailed process of selecting relevant KPIs by involving all stakeholders as part of a workshop. And that's another topic that we are going to discuss about next time. Next Tuesday, actually, we'll discuss about KPI selection as being one of the major challenges professionals are facing when it comes to work with KPIs. Overall, what you need to also retain from here is the way you can work and standardize this architecture. Yes, the way you are writing your objectives, your KPIs, and your initiatives. And I have one more slide, actually, I want to share with you. And we'll be able then to close. Let me see where I can find it. Well, it's here. Good. I don't know, maybe I can have access to it. No, so just 1 second, so I can put it on the screen and share it properly with you. Okay, and now I will share screen number 2. Good. And that's the naming standards, how you are pretty much working and standardizing your instruments names. So what is the idea here? Start all the time your objectives with an action verb, because they reflect what you do in terms of what you've planned. They reflect the doing part. You improve, you maintain, you increase, you decrease, and so on. Then in terms of initiatives, you see what happens when everything starts with an action verb. Instead of objectives, you end up with initiatives. That's a common mistake organizations are doing again. Yes, instead of ending up in the strategic framework with objectives, you end up with initiatives or tasks or milestones. One of the reasons is because of the lack of this standardization and the fact that you will start both objectives and initiatives with an action verb. So a way to avoid this is to start your initiatives with the name of the project, same as I did as I was doing this review together with you before. Start with a noun or with an adjective in front of the noun to reflect the projects. CRM, software implementation, new fleet modernization, new system development, customer satisfaction, survey deployment, and so on. I will share with you the Excel file, and you'll have as many examples of best practices in terms of how you should write objectives, KPIs, and initiatives. And when it comes to KPIs, because there are so many and you can write them in all sorts of ways, again, it's good to standardize them a little bit. And we prefer to use these three symbols in front of the KPIs and metrics names. Why? Because they reflect measurement. So metrics and KPIs are measurable expressions, hence the idea of reflecting this and knowing that what you are talking about, it's a metric or a KPI. So everything that reflects currency, it can be reals, dirhams, euros, dollars, or whatever, generally it's reflecting as we speak through the dollar sign. That's the international recognized symbol for currency. But nowadays you see that things are changing. So maybe in the future, dollar is not going to be recognized as a global reserve and the symbol will change. But until then, if you put this sign, it will reflect that it's a currency, revenue, profit, cost, investment related. Then everything that is multiplied by 100% as part of the calculation formula, it's a percentage. So you'll use the symbol accordingly for those KPIs. And everything else that's not currency related or percentage related, you can use the hashtag from the number. And then that number can mean also ratio, like kilometers per hour or kilowatts per hour, or the ratio of students to teachers or whatever you want. And you can have it as a separate field in the documentation for the unit of measurement, what this hashtag number means. Another beautiful thing is the fact that you can actually avoid writing over and over again, number of percentage of. You do not need to do that. Yes, it's redundant. The only thing that you'll need to use the symbol, start the KPI name with capital letter, and of course, you'll read it if you want and if it's required. Number of complaints, percentage of customer satisfaction. So these are some simple rules in terms of working with objectives, KPIs, and initiatives, now that we've also clarified the relation between these major components of a performance management system. And there are things that can be implemented in your organizations next day, tomorrow, if you want, or today after the program end of the webinar end. So things that they are takeaways and can be implemented, and you will see that if you are going to do this, it will save you a lot in terms of giving you clarity and ease of use. Number of days, yes, it has a symbol that will be number of days. And the target will be 1000 or whatever, if that's going to be a target. I'm just looking in one of the comments there. So that's pretty much what I want to share with you as part of this session. So we went like 45 minutes with the session. All the time, the time is very short. I would like to share with you a lot of things, but there are a few more webinars that will come soon. And I'm just working on launching sort of my broadcasting sort of my vlog. It's a professional one. It will be shared on the KPI Institute. My two cents on strategy and performance, it will be called. And I will give you 5-10 minutes insights into different topics every week. So that will be interesting. Before closing and answering your questions, and if you have questions, please try to write them down in the chat so I can answer them. Before doing that, I will just take 2 minutes, the opportunity to provide you a few recommendations regarding the services and products that the KPI Institute can support you with as part of your initiatives to improve performance. I know that the times are tough, but you can think of these things now or also later on. First of all, we've moved everything in live online. So all our certification programs are available in live online format. And the beautiful thing is that we have probably the most comprehensive portfolio of certified programs in the field of strategy and performance management at the global level, ranging from strategy and business planning to KPI professional, which is the most popular program, performance management, balance scorecard, OKRs, but also we deep dive into specific topics such as data analysis, data visualization, benchmarking, and innovation, for example. Another interesting and beautiful thing is that for a limited period of time, actually, we've put all these certifications together in one membership. So basically, professionals interested to advance their knowledge in the field of strategy and performance, they can have access to all 12 certification programs in live online format until the end of the year, if they purchase this membership. And not only that, pretty much access to our entire database of resources, dictionaries, KPIs, reports, database of KPIs with over 20,000 examples. That will be for 12 months, pretty much. And it's not a small investment, but compared with the value that it provides, it's a very, very reasonable. Basically, it's a one-in-a-lifetime opportunity in the field of strategy and performance. It's something that you can think about. Maybe you can get some funding from the companies partially, or maybe you are able to fund it yourself. But definitely, if you are interested, that's something that you should work with. Talking about all these practice domains, and that's the last thing that I want to share, many think that the KPI Institute is providing only training, and that's not the case. So it's pretty much we provide training, certifications, but also we provide consultancy, coaching, and audit in all these practice domains, ranging from strategy to KPIs, balance scorecard, performance management, and so on. Overall, end-to-end solutions in strategy and performance management. And this is something that I would like you to know and be aware of. And hopefully, if you feel that what we are doing is relevant, maybe to recommend us to your colleagues, friends, and network. And do not forget, as a follow-up to this webinar, I will send you 2 emails. One in which I will share with you the slides and the Excel file in which I've put together all that exercise, case study, and an additional one with the recording, and hopefully we'll be able to convert this recording and everything will be fine as soon as it's going to be ready. So you are going to receive 2 notifications from my side with these resources. And there I will share with you the brochures and everything else related to these programs. So you'll be able to access them if you are willing to do so. So pretty much that's what I wanted to share, I guess. I think that I've mentioned everything. Yeah. So that will be all in terms of this. And do not forget to register if you didn't do it to the next one. And next Tuesday, we'll discuss about KPI selection techniques. And again, I will try to work on Excel to see how we can actually select those KPIs that now today came up from thin air in a more proper detailed way. So that's the plan for the next webinar. Again, I will share with you the link and everything will be available for you. Thank you very much and stay safe until next time.
The KPI Institute appreciates your interest in the webinar, The Relationship Between Strategic Objectives, KPIs, and Initiatives. Follow our websites and our social media channels to find out more details about our next webinars when they get posted. Also, if you are interested in getting a certification granted by the KPI Institute on vital areas within the performance management discipline, you can explore our scheduled courses on marketplace.kpiinstitute.org. Thank you once again for your participation. We wish you the best of performance and have a nice day.